I'm Rohan Samarajiva. I'm the chair of LIRNEasia, a regional think tank active in South and Southeast Asia and to some extent in the Pacific. We deal with the infrastructure policy and regulatory issues, and we are one of the few places that work with big data for development. What I mean by big data is mobile network big data, where basically almost all the members of the populations of the countries that we work in, including the least developed countries, are actually contributing information that could be used not only for commercial purposes, as they are being used now, but also for development purposes. So what this means is that this could contribute to traffic management, it could contribute to urban planning, it could help us track the movement of infectious diseases, and help us to allocate resources, limited scarce resources that we have, in order to meet these threats. It can be dealt with in disaster situations. In some cases, we can use it, like for example, with traffic patterns, we can use it independently, that's just the mobile data. But in many cases, we have to use it with statistics from the government, additional information from additional sources. And we put them together, and they can provide us with cheap, convenient, timely data. And not only that, we could even use it for sort of experiments, in the sense that we can tell almost in real time what happened when we closed that road or made that other road one way. So we had researchers on this panel. We had people who had done research in Haiti after the earthquake and during the cholera epidemic, using mobile data, where they were able to predict certain things and help the doctors meet the threat. The speaker was Linus Bengtsson, who's actually a PhD and a doctor. And he was also talking about places like Namibia, where it is possible to look at malaria spread using data about how people move around based on their mobile data. We don't know who these people are. The data are pseudonymized, that is, there's no personal identity information, but we are dealing with millions or even billions of data over periods of time, and based on these overall massive aggregations of data, of pseudonymized data, we are able to talk about the spread of diseases. We had Sri Ganesh Loganathan from Sri Lanka, who was talking about how it could be used for urban planning, to talk about how which areas were becoming commercialized versus residential, talk about where population hotspots are, where people move during the day, where people move out during the evening, and all these kinds of very valuable information that could be used for planning purposes. We had Professor Joshua Blumenstock from the University of Washington, who was talking about how we could even identify pockets of poverty, talk about economic fluctuations in people's disposable income, things like that, that could be used. The effects of after effects of an earthquake in Rwanda. Fascinating information was shared by these data scientists. I myself work with this data, but not as a data scientist, but as a social scientist and a policy researcher, legal scholar, and as a former regulator. And we had Anthony Amendola from AT&T also dealing with the policy aspects. What is involved in giving this data for other people to analyze? Are there any privacy implications? We had lots and lots of questions. I think we must have had maybe 15, 20 questions from the audience. It was highly interactive. People were concerned about the privacy issues. People were asking about the technical details of how this could be done in their own countries, including here from here in Qatar. We had professors asking questions about the mechanics of doing these things. I think the summary of this is that there's an incredible potential in this data. I think in many cases we've had people sort of competing imaginations. The optimists see more than can be actually delivered. So for example, the reality is that we don't know whether these are men or women, or you know, gender specific targeting we can't do because we don't even know who these people are. So they expect too much. On the other side, there are the pessimists whose imaginations are running riot about all kinds of horrible things that could happen. So in this sort of battle of imaginations, I think we provide a sobering middle ground of what is really done, what can be done, and what are the actual safeguards that can be taken. So I think we had a fruitful interaction between researchers, representatives of government, international organizations, and also the companies, hardware level as well as operators. So I think all in all, it was breaking new ground for the ITU. And as coming from an organization based in the South that is working with this data and which will contribute it to better feedback to governments so that we can have improved policies.